Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Megafauna, Giant Beasts of Pleistocene, South America. By Richard A. Fariña, Sergio F. Vizcaíno, and Gerry de Iuliis. Narrated by Gary Tiedemann. The number of the remains embedded in the grand estuary deposit which forms the pampas and covers the granitic rocks of Banda Oriental must be extraordinarily great. I believe a straight line drawn in any direction through the pampas would cut through some skeleton or bones. Besides those which I found during my short excursions, I heard of many others, and the origin of such names as the stream of the animal, the hill of the giant, is obvious. At other times, I heard of the marvelous property of certain rivers, which had the power of changing small bones into large, or, as some maintained, the bones themselves grew. As far as I am aware, not one of these animals perished, as was formerly supposed, in the marshes or muddy riverbeds of the present land, but their bones have been exposed by the streams intersecting the subaqueous deposit in which they were originally embedded. We may conclude that the whole area of the pampas is one wide sepulcher of these extinct, gigantic quadrupeds. Charles R. Darwin, November 26, 1833. Preface. The first reports, during the late 1700s and early 1800s, of the fossil remains of South America's magnificent Pleistocene beasts, so fantastically bizarre, immediately caused a stir among the general public, and in particular, the European scientific community. The first notices of their discovery described them as monsters, firing the imagination and interest of several eminent scientists and politicians, and leading some of them to believe that these great beasts still wandered among the unknown, for Europeans at any rate, reaches of the New World. The fossils helped usher in a new episode among the fledgling nations in both South and North America, striving then for recognition and validation in the eyes of the established European powers. Finally, they had something of their own that rivaled the great treasures of the Old World. Eventually, the fossils contributed significantly to the establishment of new scientific institutions and traditions as the New World countries took hold of their destinies and exploration of their territories. The fossil mammals of both North and South America began to reveal an unimagined chapter in the history of mammals, based as it then was mainly on knowledge unearthed from European deposits. But it was those from South America that were most strikingly different and garnered much of the early attention. Perhaps because of this distinctness, largely as a result of the long, past isolation of South America from other continental land masses, they played crucial roles in the development of modern biological thought. We may note as examples of their scientific achievements that a South American fossil mammal, Megatherium americanum, a giant fossil sloth, was the first fossil to be formally described and named scientifically, and its skeleton was the first to be mounted in a lifelike pose. The sharp mind of Georges Cuvier, the great French comparative anatomist, forged the concept of extinction in the modern sense of this word, based on this fossil sloth, as well as on North and South American remains of fossil elephant relatives. Perhaps most significantly, it was the giant sloths, the giant armadillo-like glyptodonts, and the majestic and ponderous toxodonts, among other South American fossil remains, that struck most fervently upon the fertile mind of the young Charles Darwin, both during and after his famous voyage aboard the HMS Beagle, as he worked out his ideas on evolutionary theory. Despite the relative isolation of the new South American countries, these ideas greatly affected scientists and intellectuals on both sides of the Rio de la Plata, several of whom, such as the Ameghinos, took on the void created by Darwin's return to England and restarted the study of the South American fossil mammals with renewed enthusiasm. Such was their influence that it even affected the excited atmosphere of the newly born city of La Plata, which inspired an illustration that adorns one of the entrances of the División Paleontología de Vertebrados of the Museo de La Plata. As explained in Chapter 8, it was conceived at the end of the 19th century, just after the city's founding, as an artist's rendition of a plan to embellish the gardens between the museum and the neighboring zoo, two of the proud city's new jewels. In these gardens, visitors could stroll between the institutions that housed the living and the long dead, and have a sense of those extinct beasts, brought back to life in the form of life-sized sculptures. Despite such an early and auspicious beginning, the study and our understanding of South America's extinct mammals has generally lagged behind those from most other continents. In part, this is certainly due to their distinctness, generally leading scientists to either consider them too odd to expend much energy on, or regard them as somewhat inferior variants of more typical mammals, as was once done for dinosaurs. In accepting such views, the past was condemned to be more or less like the present, and the magnificent mammals of South America relegated to being antiquated curiosities of better and more modern mammalian designs. In this book, we endeavor to reveal that such views are erroneous. Despite their differences and the fact that no living analogs exist for many native South American mammals, thus making comparisons difficult, we show that these mammals and the environments in which they lived and evolved were likely not merely slight variations of those that exist today. Their study is thus entirely worth the effort. By combining a wide variety of techniques from several biological disciplines, researchers over the past decade or so have begun bringing these beasts back to life. The picture that has begun to emerge is that of a marvelous biota that resists being pigeonholed, one that at once enlightens our concept of mammalness and enhances our knowledge of the past. We begin our story in Chapter 1 with an introduction to the splendor of the South American megafauna, the assemblage of large-sized and gigantic beasts, or megamammals, that are the main subject of this book. In addition, we provide an analysis of how paleontology, and science in general, works, discussing its place among the evolutionary sciences, and consider other relevant background topics, such as the role of fossilization, geology, and biological classification. This sets the stage for the more detailed discussions of the mammals and their environments provided in later chapters. We continue in Chapter 2 by outlining the historical contributions to the study of South America's fossil mammals, a pantheon of researchers whose efforts illuminate our present knowledge, for these are the giants on whose shoulders modern paleontologists stand. Chapter 3 provides more detailed discussions, begun in Chapter 1, of the geological and ecological contexts in which this fauna evolved. These historical contexts are indispensable, for they allow us to understand the natures of and differences between the Pleistocene and modern South American fossil assemblages. This theme is continued in Chapter 4, which focuses particularly on the North American fauna and its relationship with that of South America, although we are getting ahead of ourselves. Much of the Pleistocene faunas, and to an even greater degree modern South American faunas, are ultimately of North American origin, and thus the northern stock plays an integral role in our story. In Chapter 5, we bring together the diverse threads of the previous chapters as we discuss the history of the native South American mammals, the geological processes leading to the emergence of the Isthmus of Panama, finally ending South America's long isolation, and the episode that followed, the extensive intermingling of the North and South American faunas, known as the Great American Biotic Interchange, and its consequences. As well, we consider the habitats present in the Pleistocene, which served as the essential backdrop to the events occurring among the mammals. Chapter 6 rejoices in the wonders of this splendid assemblage by focusing on many of the main large-bodied species, noting their relationships, main characteristics, and roles as members of the fauna. Chapters 7 and 8 outline our more recent attempts at bringing these mammals back to life, or at least in viewing them as having once been real flesh-and-blood beasts, rather than the dry and scattered bones that we have left of them. We provide explanations of some of the methods used to study the paleobiology and paleoecology of these animals, particularly of the giants, and present the results of such research into their habits, ecology, metabolism, appearance, lifestyles, and diets. As is generally known, the magnificent megafauna of South America and several other continents is no more. Chapter 9 presents our attempts to explain the demise of these beasts. The extinction of the megafauna is a touchy subject. Whereas we are generally content to explain away other extinction events, of the non-avian dinosaurs, for example, as due to any, all, or some combination of environmental, tectonic, catastrophic, and climatic factors, the disappearance, only some 10,000 years ago, of the South American Pleistocene megafauna occurred in the presence of humans, and debate rages on the role, if any, that humans played. Our treatment of the subject is set within the framework of the competing hypotheses with all their scientific and ethical implications. Chapter 1. Paleontology and Science. What is science? Introduction. South America, the southern half of the pole-to-pole landmass named, according to the usual attribution, after the Italian merchant and cartographer Amerigo Vespucci, or, as convincingly argued by Lloyd and Mitchinson, after the wealthy Bristol merchant Richard Americ, a main investor in Giovanni Caboto's second transatlantic voyage, remains a territory full of interest, intrigue, and biological treasures. Artificially severed from the northern half by the Panama Canal, it extends from the tropics, where the marvelous Amazonian rainforest offers its biological diversity and chemical riches of trapped carbon, to the elevations and endless steppes of Patagonia, its tapered south that points at and nearly touches frozen Antarctica. From west to east, the assortment of landscapes includes the soaring Andes, followed in places by the Altiplano that so aroused past greed for silver and gold, and then descends into the low-lying eastern plains, where the fossils discussed in this book have mainly been found. Despite this variety in habitats, latitudes, and altitudes, the great naturalist Georges-Louis Leclerc, better known as Comte de Buffon, claimed that South America lacked enough vital energy to yield true giants among its fauna. Indeed, the present-day fauna boasts no true megamammals, that is, those for which body mass is given in tons, or megagrams, hence the term. Impressive as it is for a rodent, the capybara, at 60 kilograms, can hardly lay claim for membership in the same category as elephants and rhinos. Also of similar size are two xenarthrons, a group of mammals particularly characteristic of South America, the giant armadillo, Priodontis maximus, and the giant anteater, Myrmecophaga tridactyla, both sadly of dwindling populations, for which the adjective applies only in comparison with their close kin, but not if placed side by side with hippos and giraffes. The largest South American mammal is the tapir, whose bulk, approximately 300 kilograms, is less than striking compared with bison. Among carnivores, the jaguar is the largest, but it cannot match other top predators, such as lions and tigers, respectively 2 and 3 times its size. It was Charles Darwin himself who corrected Buffon. Rather than absence, the reality for huge South American mammals is recent demise. 10,000 years ago, an instant in terms of geologic time, South America was inhabited by a mammalian fauna so large, diverse, and rare that today's African national parks would pale in comparison. Bears, saber-toothed cats, and elephant-like gomphotheres lived alongside much larger-than-extent 150-kilogram capybaras and oversized llamas. Horses roamed these lands and went extinct thousands of years before Spanish explorers reintroduced the domestic species. In addition to these relatively familiar mammals, there were also bizarre creatures only distantly related to modern forms, such as terrestrial sloths, several meters in height when standing bipedally, completely armored glyptodonts, hippo-sized animals related to armadillos, the camel-like macrauchenids, and the rhino-like toxodonts, weird yet strangely familiar in echoing the ungulate or hoof-bearing types common in North America, Africa, and Asia. Thanks to the efforts of many people, both collectors who found and prepared the material, often in decidedly uncomfortable and in some cases outright dangerous conditions, and scholars who interpreted those remains, we have now resurrected them for our contemplation and awe. Traveling today through the sparsely populated regions of South America, it boggles the mind to think that the plains and low hills were once filled by a fauna so grand that it was rivaled only by the dinosaurs in magnificence. But unlike these long-extinct creatures of the Mesozoic, the South American fauna is much closer to us in time and in the phylogenetic or genealogical relationships to living mammals, as well as being more abundantly preserved. It is, therefore, easier to understand the biology and infer the ways of life of these magnificent mammals. Further, the extraction of genetic material from the more recent fossils is already being accomplished, in contrast to the currently impossible science fiction world of Jurassic Park. Perhaps even more intriguing is that some of these mammals co-inhabited these lands with early Americans, who may, regrettably, have had a hand in their demise. In this book, we deal with the life and times of these remarkable beasts, the adaptations they evolved, their origin and journeys, the ecology of those not-so-long-ago times, and the possible reasons for their extinction. All these subjects are dear to paleontology, a discipline that claims its own place within science. Most people think of paleontologists as adventurous individuals dashing through remote areas of the world to find and dig out dinosaur bones. Although it is true that paleontologists need fossils to understand life of the past, their scope of knowledge and skills is broader than that required to unearth old dead things. Paleontologists usually receive broad training in both biology and geology, and they are generally equally comfortable in the field, deciphering the geology of the area under investigation, and in the lab, researching and describing the material they have collected. The latter, in particular, requires a wide knowledge of living organisms. How else could we hope to understand the way extinct animals appeared and behaved from the meager scraps we have left of them? This requires, among other things, an extensive knowledge of anatomy. It is no coincidence that many paleontologists also teach comparative anatomy in universities and human anatomy in medical schools. Paleontology falls under the aegis of evolutionary biology, the scientific field that deals with the remarkable diversity of the organic world, past and present. The theory of evolution, the cornerstone of modern biology, includes the set of ideas explaining how and why evolution occurs. It is one of science's most robust theories, supported by an impressive array of evidence. Surprisingly, it also happens to be among those scientific theories that the general public is least confident in. A recent poll among Britons, for example, indicated that fewer than half of respondents accept the theory of evolution as the best explanation for the development of life, with nearly 40% opting instead for some form of creationism, the set of ideas that rely on some sort of supernatural creator or designer as an explanation for the origin and diversity of life. The situation in the United States is pretty much the same as in the United Kingdom. It seems incredible that one of science's strongest theories should be viewed with such skepticism in such a scientifically and technologically advanced nation. Then again, some have cast doubt on the theory of evolution and voiced support for the teaching of intelligent design theory in U.S. public schools. This position was soundly routed in U.S. District Judge John E. Jones's 2005 ruling against Pennsylvania's Dover Area School Board's decision to insert intelligent design into the public school science curriculum. In one of the most stinging criticisms of creationism to date, Judge Jones noted the overwhelming evidence that establishes intelligent design as a religious view, a mere relabeling of creationism rather than a scientific theory, and he condemned the breathtaking inanity of the Dover Board's policy, accusing some of the board members of lying to conceal their true motive of promoting religion. Much of the public's suspicion of evolution is the result of a consistent battle waged by a small, but politically active and well-connected fundamentalist religious faction that has tried to disparage evolution while trying to impose its own viewpoint on U.S. public schools. That is, on students during what is probably their most intellectually vulnerable stage. Originally a concern mainly in the United States, creationism has taken root in other Western nations over the last two decades. Its onslaughts on science have both contributed to and played upon, in synergistic fashion, the general public's misperception of what science is. It is one thing when people who have not received a higher level of education are swayed by creationists, especially as many people start out their school careers already inculcated with some worldview that includes elements of creationism. It is quite another when the more highly educated members of society, U.S. polls indicate about 40% of college graduates do not believe that humans evolved from some other mammals, and indeed, a former leader of the nation, a Yale University graduate with any number of highly qualified advisors supposedly at his disposal, misunderstand science. It is even worse when many professional academics venture into a field not their own, and with an embarrassingly limited understanding of the subject, remedied by even a first-year university-level course, decide they are qualified to hold forth on the perceived inadequacies of evolutionary theory. To place this sort of dabbling into perspective, imagine an evolutionary biologist trying to set a nuclear physicist straight on real or imagined inconsistencies in the theory of quantum mechanics due to interpretations over the value of particle accelerators. It is so preposterous an idea that we wouldn't even take its proposition seriously. Yet, we must wonder why so few eyebrows are raised when, rather than if, the reverse happens. There seem to be two main reasons why so many people have an aversion to evolution. One is that evolution happens to touch on aspects of humanity dear to many of us, our place in this universe, and the meaning and purpose of our lives. The centrality of these facets leads many of us to assert that our personal convictions are as equally valid explanatory tools as evolutionary theory in dealing with the diversity, development, and history of life on this planet. However, this is simply not true. Evolutionary theory analyzes the physical and behavioral changes in the forms of life over time and provides explanations for how those changes occurred. That such changes have occurred is beyond any reasonable doubt. Opinions on such questions are not equally valid, any more so than is any particular person's opinion on whether matter is really composed of atoms or the Earth revolves around the sun. There may still be people somewhere in the world that believe in a flat Earth. Their opinion, bluntly put, simply does not count. Evolutionary theory does not deal with, nor does it purport to deal with, questions of spirituality, which, for reasons explained momentarily, are outside the realm of science. Many scientists, including a good number of evolutionary biologists such as Francisco J. Ayala, have reconciled religion and science, maintaining their spiritual faith while recognizing the fact of evolution. Another reason why people mistrust evolution has to do with how they view science. This calls into question the effectiveness and role of science education in much of Western society. Science education has made great strides in the last half century or so, particularly in conveying scientific knowledge. Yet, we have to wonder whether our emphasis on presenting the results and successes of scientific investigation has overshadowed the more basic principles of how we arrive at that knowledge, on what actually qualifies as science. If we have done our job properly, then by the time a student graduates from high school, given that we start science education in the elementary grades, the student would have a perfectly good grasp of what science is and what it is meant to do, and there would be little, if any, reason for debate on whether we can accept evolution as scientific or whether it is true or not, because it is only a theory, after all. When almost half of college graduates, in the United States at least, are confused, it might be a sign that we are not doing all we can as educators. Given the current level of misunderstanding about science in general, and to place the information of this book in context, it is worth spending time to consider what science is. Science is so important to modern society that rarely does a day go by without a media report on some new discovery. It is perhaps because science is so ubiquitous that we have begun to take it for granted and fail to reflect on just what it is that's behind the headlines. This is certainly one reason why science is so misunderstood. But the fact that so many people complete their formal education without understanding the fundamentals of science means that we may not be instructing students properly, or at least not emphasizing the essentials. What is it about science that makes it so special? Most people view scientists as diligently working away to fill in some piece of a giant puzzle, a great edifice of knowledge that, once completed, would represent the truth about the way nature works. This picture is misleading. Scientists are not out to seek some universal truth, at least not in the way most people understand truth. At best, we can say that scientists are out to describe the way that nature works, and that the best we can usually do is to arrive at some approximation of the truth. Science provides us with tentative answers. Any scientist worth his or her salt realizes that any answer is provisional, and can expect to be corrected or revised. Eventually, a larger understanding of nature's workings is achieved, but this knowledge is always based on our current abilities to perceive nature. If new techniques or conceptual frameworks provide us with novel ways of analyzing phenomena, then we can expect our conceptualization of nature to change. This is precisely what happened when we switched our picture of matter and motion from a Newtonian to a quantum perspective. This means that there is no giant puzzle to fill in. A puzzle is static, whereas science is a dynamic process, constantly rearranging its view of how nature works, with scientists accepting new ideas and rejecting old ones as the need arises. The fact that there is change does not mean that the methods used to discover the knowledge are invalid or somehow inferior. Indeed, we have made enormous strides over the past 300 years in understanding the natural world using these methods, which have been far more successful than any other method humankind has devised. The success of science lies in its methodology. Science is factual knowledge of the natural world gained through an unbiased procedure that is generally labeled as the scientific method. That is, we can think of science as consisting of a body of information or knowledge, facts in most people's estimation. For example, an atom of hydrogen has a single proton in its nucleus. As well, science is a human endeavor. It also includes the way by using scientific methodology, we obtain that knowledge. In considering how scientists carry out their activities, we can begin to explore the essence of what makes science so successful at revealing the workings of the natural world. Through prior knowledge and observations, scientists propose ideas about some particular facet of nature. Why do they do this? In part, it is because, like most people, scientists are inquisitive beings. Further, scientists are generally driven to understand their particular corner of the universe. It is simply part of who they are. However, many people have ideas, so simply coming up with ideas isn't what sets science apart. Once a scientist formulates an idea, it is evaluated by putting it through some sort of test, then published so that it is available to the scientific community, though usually only a small number of scientists are interested in or qualified to evaluate it. There, in the scientific arena, it is open to further scrutiny and testing. Other scientists can check this idea, evaluating whether it might indeed be a valid description of nature. How do scientists do this? By banding together and trying to prove it, as many people might believe? No, it is precisely the opposite. Scientists try to knock it down. They try to show that it is not correct. In short, they try to falsify it. Scientists are not striving to prove something, because they realize that certainty is unattainable. So, how does science advance our knowledge? Before we get to this, let's consider why scientists would want to test another's ideas. There can be many reasons. Some scientists may disagree on the basis of their own observations and research. They may have competing ideas that they either have already proposed or are in the process of developing. They may simply doubt a scientist's results based on their understanding of the way nature works. Being human, scientists also sometimes dislike one another. They may be envious of each other, or they may be competing for a limited pool of research funds. Whatever the reasons, and we hope that they are more often than not of the nobler variety, the point is that ideas are tested. When scientists formulate ideas, they are careful to state them in such a way that they are open to testing or to being falsified. If a proposal is not open to falsification, then it is not considered scientific. This is why creationism, whether labeled as scientific creationism or intelligent design theory, is not and can never be scientific. These attempts begin by asserting that creationism and its tenets are true based on faith. If there is evidence that refutes any part of creationism, say that the Earth is only a few thousand years old, then it is the evidence that is wrong, because creationism must be true. Faith, by definition, is not open to testing, otherwise it wouldn't be faith. Science accepts only natural explanations, because supernatural explanations are not testable. The instant we resort to a supernatural explanation, we have stopped doing science altogether. Science is grounded in doubt rather than faith, and so ideas must be testable. When a testable idea, technically termed a hypothesis, resists falsification, scientists' confidence that it is an accurate description of nature is strengthened. We can reformulate the sequence of events given into the more formal and stereotypical flowchart that most students are exposed to during the primary and secondary school years. This is the classic scientific method that so many of us have grown up with. This stereotype, however, is yet another hurdle to overcome, for students come away with the idea that it is the scientific method. Educators rarely go beyond it to explain that this method, the experimental method, is not the only one. It is critically important in many scientific fields, particularly those amenable to investigating phenomena in artificial environments, such as a laboratory, where the researcher has control over which and how many variables, or factors, are manipulated. Examples are much of physics and chemistry. However, it is unsuitable for investigating many scientific questions, such as those posed by much, but clearly not all, of cosmology, biology, geology, and meteorology, and paleontology. These disciplines, which rely on other equally valid methods, are usually considered historical sciences because they investigate phenomena resulting from past events that cannot be recreated in a laboratory setting. Although aspects of these sciences are important components of school curricula, it is the experimental method, which is inappropriate for these sciences, that is typically presented to students. If students fail to make the link between the material they are learning and the method they are told is used to investigate scientific questions, we should not be surprised. The correlation does not exist. A volcanic eruption or the movement of the Earth's crust cannot be recreated in a laboratory. Certainly, they may be modeled, but that is not the same thing, as explained in Chapter 9. Neither can the beginning of the universe, nor the interactions among the factors involved in ecological settings. For example, in many cases, there is no way to experiment with an ecological system that does not also alter the system. If we wanted to know what would happen to a system if one element, say, a top carnivore, were eliminated, we could not do this experimentally. It would be neither ethical nor desirable to exterminate the species in question to determine the outcome of its absence. In such realms of study, scientists are presented with outcomes that are the result of historical and therefore non-repeatable events. The experiment, so to speak, has already been performed, in this case by nature, and it is the task of the scientist to unravel the conditions and factors responsible for producing the results. Scientists involved in such questions use a methodology called the comparative method. The comparative method, then, is used to investigate the situations, or natural experiments, where variables cannot be manipulated because they occurred in the past, because they are impossible to manipulate, or because it is unethical to do so. It is termed comparative because the researcher investigates by comparison of situations that differ in the variable of interest. It is often necessary to set up classification systems to accomplish this. If we are interested, for example, in comparing habitats, then categories such as top predators and physical factors must be defined and described so that similarities and differences may be recognized in the first place. The researcher proceeds by observing the outcomes of the natural experiment based on the varying components of the different systems under study. In other words, by reconstructing what must have been the conditions that produced the outcomes. Let's consider a simplified scenario to illustrate how the comparative method may be used to test hypotheses. In our example, we are investigating an ecosystem that contains a top predator, such as a tiger, and a potential prey species, such as an antelope. We have noticed a dramatic decline in the numbers of antelope, and hypothesize that the tigers must be responsible. How can we test this hypothesis? One way is to seek another ecosystem where tigers are scarce or absent. If the antelope are in decline there as well, it suggests our hypothesis is wrong. If the antelope population is in good shape, however, it suggests, but does not prove, that our hypothesis might be correct. Although many aspects of biology and other sciences rely on the comparative method, this does not mean that all activities in these fields do. For many biological disciplines, such as physiology, anatomy, and molecular biology, the experimental method is clearly applicable. Others, such as ecology, systematics, and paleontology, normally rely on the comparative method. Many of the results discussed in this book, therefore, were obtained by means of the comparative method. In some cases, though, a combination of comparative and experimental methods were used, such as in the analysis of functional anatomy. Before we leave the subject of the nature of science, we must address yet one more aspect that causes confusion, and this is the difference between fact and theory, and what scientists mean by theory. Many people equate facts with certainty, but are less confident about theories. Most believe that there is a gradation between fact, an incontrovertible truth, and theory, as though a theory were not quite as good as fact, but something that is still awaiting proof. A fact is an observable, keeping in mind that observation includes more than just sight, attribute of nature. Let's consider gravity as a familiar example. If an object were dropped from a height, it is possible that it would fall up. But we recognize that the innumerable observations made about what happens to dropped objects makes the probability of such an event infinitesimally small, and we recognize that gravity exists. It is a fact. The theory of gravity is an attempt to explain why it exists and how it functions, and is decidedly not a discourse on whether gravity exists. Gravity would exist regardless of why we think it exists. Similarly, that evolution has occurred and continues to do so is indicated by numerous observations from many areas of knowledge. The theory of evolution is an explanation of why and how evolution occurs. It may be that some aspects of our ideas on how evolution occurs may be wrong, which is something that only scientific methodology could reveal and correct. More to the point here, however, is that our being wrong would have absolutely no effect on evolution's factuality, which is supported by overwhelming evidence. As another example, consider that when, some 4 centuries ago, the religious establishment debated leading philosophers on whether to accept or reject the heliocentric explanation for the motion of celestial bodies in our solar system, the planets took no mind and continued to do what they had always done. They did not care in the least what humans thought. A theory in science has a precise meaning that is distinct from its colloquial use. In everyday language, a theory is something akin to an opinion, as when, in a murder mystery show, one detective asks another for his theory on what happened. In science, a theory is an explanation or a set of explanations for some attribute of the natural world that scientists have come to accept as being the best explanation at a particular time. Scientists do not accept theories because they have been proven to be correct. Recall that scientists do not strive to provide proof, although scientists, being human, sometimes slip up in everyday talk and refer to the proof of one thing or another, but because they have resisted repeated attempts to disprove them. Generally, theories start out as hypotheses that are tested over and over again. When scientists are sufficiently confident of their explanatory power, they come to be considered theories. A further caveat about scientists is necessary. They often speak about their own ideas as theories, when in fact they should refer to them as hypotheses. Unless, of course, the ideas have been accepted by other scientists as the best possible explanation. To start applying these concepts to the disciplines that study the life of the past, the raw materials of paleontology, the fossil remains of once living organisms are discussed in the following section. Fossils and taphonomy. Who has not marveled at the discovery of something ancient, or come across dusty family albums in the attic, the staid expressions of our great-grandparents staring back at us, as though wondering what planet they were being observed from? Who has not stood in wonder at discovering an ancient object casually found in a field and reflected on the hand that gave it form? Human beings, like many other mammals, are curious creatures, and questions on origins, on what once was and now is no longer, often stand uppermost in our thoughts. This is probably the main reason why there are professional students of the past, men and women who earn their living scrutinizing the past through the years, centuries, millennia, or eras, according to their own personal interests. In particular, the historian of ancient life is designated by a wonderful word of Hellenic elegance, a paleontologist. To decipher its meaning, let's examine its component parts. Palaios in Greek means old. Ontos refers to existing things, and thus is a roundabout way of referring to life. And logos means a treatment or discussion, and by extension, the body of knowledge associated with it, or in other words, the corresponding branch of science. Thus, paleontology is the scientific field that is concerned with ancient life. The paleontologist lives and breathes fossils. The etymology of the word fossil is ambiguous. It is certainly derived from Latin, but its precise meaning is not easy to translate. Probably the most appropriate translation is dug up, referring to the fact that fossils are usually buried and that a pick is the favored, or at least stereotypical, tool of the trade. Actually, in centuries past, the term fossil was used to describe a wide array of things that were dug up, such as gems and interesting concretions, as well as objects that we now recognize as fossils. As we shall see, one South American mammal in particular was important in helping establish what fossils, in the modern usage of this term, represent. The erstwhile pick is the tool of choice for most of the cases we discuss in this book. But not all fossils are the same. Most people think of fossils as the lithified remains of bones, teeth, and shells. A good number are, but fossils include much more than animal remains that have been turned to stone. A fossil is defined as any trace, impression, or remains of a once-living organism. Thus, a set of footprints preserved along an ancient mudflat is a fossil, as are tracks, trails, and burrows made by crawling invertebrates, or even more esoterically, boreholes made by predatory organisms in the shell of clams. Two fossils in one. Some fossils may be microscopic. For example, the deposition of plant pollen, as with dead plankton in general that sinks to the bottom of a body of water, is almost imperceptible. The fragmentary remains of small mammals and birds are surrounded by resistant matrix. The use of a pick to recover such fossils, given the good fortune that they are preserved at all, is akin to using a shotgun to scatter flies. Instead, the remains are removed along with a good deal of the surrounding rock. A rock saw often comes in handy, and then packaged in a protective jacket, usually made of plaster, for safe transfer back to a laboratory. But even when digging out the bones that are normally thought of as fossils, we face a common dilemma. The bones, large or small, are often fragile. Their extraction requires great patience and the delicacy of a brush and needle rather than brute force. The surrounding matrix must be removed, often grain by grain. In the laboratory, various techniques may be used, and the fossil itself must be coated with frequent applications of a dilute cohesive that penetrates its substance. The old saying that paleontology could not exist without glue is an exaggeration, but it is not too far off the mark. However, before the wondrous moment when the remains of an animal or plant from an age long past are extracted, a seemingly miraculous series of events must occur. The scientific field that studies these events is called taphonomy, which refers, according to the paleontologist I.A. Efremov, who coined the term, to the laws of burial, or, more expansively, the study of the transition of remains from the biosphere, the realm of living organisms, to the lithosphere, rocks, or the inanimate world. If something is to be transformed into a fossil, then the natural recycling of material must be interrupted at some point. Usually, nature recycles all the materials previously incorporated into once-living organisms, because the Earth's resources are limited, and we cannot count on meteors and comets for perpetual deliveries of extraterrestrial supplies. Even though these resources exist in great quantities, they would be exhausted with the inexorable passing of time. This does not occur, though, because the lithosphere receives continuous transfer of material from the biosphere. Fossilization may appear to be nothing less than miraculous, the outcome of an improbable series of events. It occurs, however, because the uncountable number of opportunities that are available without pause during the extremely long periods of time that nature takes in going about its business. For an organism to become fossilized, it must first die in such a way that it avoids being completely devoured by another animal. Not such an easy trick in the real world. And then further hope that its more resistant parts are not feasted on by putrefying bacteria. One common way for this to happen is to be buried quickly. But even in such cases, not all bones that survive postmortem events reach a sedimentary environment conducive for preservation. In other words, it depends on where they are finally laid to rest. Fluvial sediments are often a good bet for a bone bent on becoming a fossil. On the other hand, for example, we have a relatively poor record of forest-dwelling animals because the acidic soils of forests lead to disintegration of buried bones. The different parts of an organism have different potentials for fossilization. Fortunately for us, we share a common interest with most organisms. They happen to require protective and supportive structures, which, as a result of the nature of their functions, are quite resistant. We, on the other hand, can discern a great deal from such structures, when and if we can find them. Protective and skeletal structures are formed by a few primary materials common in the biological world. The shell of mollusks, for example, are made of calcium carbonate, a material with great potential for fossilization. It is not mere coincidence that the bones of vertebrates are those most commonly associated with the word fossil. The calcium phosphate that forms them is stupendously well preserved. Similarly, this occurs with teeth, which are the hardest elements of the vertebrate skeleton. The most common examples of fossils are formed by petrification, which results in stony or lithified remains, and may occur by two processes. Permineralization occurs when soft structures decay while water containing dissolved minerals works its way into every nook and cranny of the hard structures. Minerals are then deposited in these cavities and pores, resulting in a fossil that still contains a good deal of its original hard parts. Replacement occurs when water dissolves the original material forming the hard structures and replaces them with minerals. This may happen so slowly that the new minerals duplicate almost exactly the shape and structure of the original organic material. Other readily fossilized substances include silicon, which forms the coverings of diatoms and other microscopic organisms. Chitin, present primarily in the covering of insects and other arthropods, but also in lichens, earthworms, and other invertebrates. And cellulose, which provides rigidity to the cell walls of plants. Once in a while, the impossible happens. Soft tissues, the daily bread of bacteria and predators, escape decomposition and present us with precious information that is almost always missing in the fossil record. Even more remarkably, once in a long while, an organism may be so completely preserved that its last meal is too, as occurs in deposits from near Messel, Germany. The process of decomposition may be interrupted or altered in the absence of oxygen. This is the case in natural mummification, when the environment is too dry and hot for bacteria to carry on their activities. One example is the famous mammoths of Siberia, some so well preserved in ice that a banquet with a main course of a mammoth trunk was served at an academic gathering. At least, that's the way the story is usually told. However, it may be apocryphal and based on the assumption that the mammoths were frozen extremely rapidly in some sort of extraordinary climatic catastrophe. The famous paleontologist, Bjorn Curtin, suggested that what probably happened is that one member of the mammoth hunting expedition made a heroic attempt to consume a bit of mammoth to eat, but could not quite get it down. It seems that the carcasses had been partly decomposed before freezing. Still, the flesh was so well preserved that someone might actually have tried. Soft tissues may also be preserved by substitution of the organic matrix by minerals. At times, this happens in so perfect a manner that the nature of the original structures may be studied microscopically. Wonderful examples of this sort of preservation occur in Lower Cretaceous rocks dated at about 125 Maya of the Yishan Formation of the Liaoning Province, China. These deposits preserve not only such delicate structures as skin and insect wings, but also feathered dinosaurs, findings that have revolutionized our idea of how some dinosaurs looked and lived. Fossil tree trunks, which are not overly rare, may also be subject to such fine preservation. In Patagonia, there is a petrified forest, declared a national monument, that preserves the trunks, branches, and even fruit in exquisite detail. There is also a petrified forest in Arizona, and the conifer trunks in Yellowstone Park are petrified. Further, fecal material may be fossilized under the right conditions. These fossils, termed coprolites, are invaluable because they can reveal dietary information, such as pollen, fiber, bones, and shells. The coprolites of several fossil sloth species have been recovered. Paleontologists' traditional ideas of how fossilization occurs involves the replacement of the original tissue, including soft tissues, by minerals to produce a hard or lithified representation of the original. Several remarkable recent discoveries hint at other methods of preservation that suggest that fossilized remains need not be restricted to lithification of structures. Remains of what seem to be Mesozoic soft tissues of dinosaurs have been reported, essentially like those of modern species. In addition to preservation of tissue, scientists have uncovered preserved protein sequences. These are real molecules present in the organism during the time it was alive. Fossilization of such materials was once thought to be impossible, as scientists could not conceive of a way that such fossilization could occur. Although the fossilization method is still unclear, it appears, at least in the case of tissue preservation, to have something to do with post-mortem formation of polymers, long-chained molecules that become inert and thus resistant to further chemical changes. But it does not end there. Fossilization requires still further luck. Once buried, structures still face the possibility of destruction from the pressure of overlying sediments. Finally, there is erosion, the paradoxical ally of the paleontologist. Erosion exposes a fossil originally buried deep within sediments, but there is only a small window of opportunity, for if the remains are not recovered, the same forces will destroy them. A fragment of an organism is exposed to and must survive all of these risks before it may finally rest in relative peace in the drawers of a collection. Then it must be studied. But here, the adventure becomes, to use Einstein's definition of science, one of thought. These adventures are referred to next and in Chapter 2, exemplified through the activities of the people who have dealt with the fossil animals that are the subject of this book. Linnaeus and classification. Taxonomy is the branch of the biological sciences that establishes the rules for and carries out the classification of living organisms. Classifying things, be they animate or inanimate, is an essential practice that helps humans keep track and make sense of the numerous objects and concepts that we must deal with daily. We can classify most inanimate objects fairly easily on the basis of their unchanging features. Nearly anyone living in a modern industrialized society would be able to pick out a van from an SUV, pickup, Jeep, convertible, sedan, hatchback, station wagon, and so on. The reason is that we all agree on the features that distinguish these different subcategories of the category motor vehicles. If we were to switch languages, say from English to Spanish, then we would simply have to learn a new vocabulary. Well, and grammar too. Living things also need to be named. For many purposes, their names are not terribly important. It doesn't much matter if people refer to their local species of chickadee as the black-capped chickadee, the boreal chickadee, or simply call it a chickadee, especially if it's the only one in the area. For formal scientific purposes, however, the naming of organisms is critically important and not as straightforward. Further, as we shall see, we cannot use characters to define groups of organisms. Scientists face two problems. One is naming all the different units or kinds of life, technically known as species, and making sure that no two closely similar species have the same name. When scientists from different parts of the world communicate about a species, they need to be sure that they are talking about the same thing. It may sound trivial, but the vast diversity of life forms can lead to considerable confusion. In some cases, a single species may have many informal local or common names, not due solely to the fact that scientists from different countries speak distinct languages. And, at the other extreme, different species may have the same common name. The second problem for scientists is how to organize the bewildering number of living and extinct species so that a broader understanding of life, including interactions and relationships among its components, and how it arose and diversified, can be achieved. Successful scientific resolutions to these problems began about 250 years ago with the work of the Swedish naturalist Carl von Linné, 1707 to 1778. Better known to us as Carolus Linnaeus, he served stints as army doctor and physician to the king, but his main calling, during and after duty to king and country, was as a botanist at the universities of Stockholm and Uppsala. He also served as president of the Academy of Sciences. Linnaeus solved the vexing problem of naming species, bringing stability to what had been a chaotically confusing profusion of names by devising a system based on binomial nomenclature. Since then, each species has been christened according to this system, with names rigorously derived from Latin or Latinized colloquial words. More recently, this rule has been relaxed, and names need no longer conform to Latin. In Linnaeus's system, the name of each species has two parts, hence binomial nomenclature, a generic name and a specific epithet, or trivial name. The first letter of the generic name is capitalized, and both the generic name and specific epithet are italicized, or underlined, to set them off from surrounding text. For example, two closely similar species are the wolf, known scientifically as Canis lupus, and the coyote, known as Canis latrans. These species are in the same genus, but have their own specific epithets. Although the naming of species, or taxonomy, is governed by a complex set of rules and requires knowledge of a specialized vocabulary, the important point is that binomial nomenclature allows unambiguous communication among scientists. A second concern for biologists is that simply naming individual species is not sufficient. It is not of much help in organizing the vast diversity of life forms. The discipline that deals with the more encompassing aspects of organisms' biology is termed systematics. It is distinct from taxonomy, which concerns itself with the naming of organisms. Systematists are therefore concerned with all biological aspects of a group of organisms, including the relationship among them and their way of life. Linnaeus realized this as well, and tackled the problem by grouping species into higher categories on the basis of similarities and by assigning groups a rank as indication of the degree of distinctness from other groups. For example, he included such mammals as cats, hyenas, dogs, wolves, jackals, bears, and weasels in the carnivora, and gave this group the rank of order. In doing so, he implied a degree of difference from mammals in other orders, such as the artiodactyla, though we tend these days not to use this term as a formal name, which includes cows, sheep, goats, pigs, deer, moose, and camels. All the different groups of mammals were collected together under the class Mammalia. Class is a higher level rank than order, signaling that groups of organisms in different classes were separated by a greater degree of difference than those included as orders of the same class. As an example, crocodiles, turtles, lizards, and snakes were grouped into class Reptilia, implying a markedly different form and way of life than those classified under Mammalia. Similarly, the class Biscis, containing all the fishes, emphasized the distinctness of its members from those of other classes. This method led naturally to the use of characters to define species or higher categories. Linnaeus's resulting classification, the Systema Naturae, System of Nature, organized the diversity of life into a hierarchical pattern of decreasing inclusiveness. The further down the hierarchy, the fewer the members. Linnaeus's methods met with resounding success, mainly because his system was vastly superior to those proposed by other naturalists. It remained essentially intact until just a few decades ago, even surviving Darwin's intellectual upheaval. Most readers are familiar with the primary categories in common use since the early 1800s: kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, and species. In practice, biologists have availed themselves of intermediate categories by using prefixes, for example, super and subfamilies, or entirely new categories, for example, tribe and cohort. Linnaeus's efforts were deeply grounded in the Western cultural and social fabric of the day, decidedly Christian, and carried out to demonstrate God's greater glory and wisdom. He was, however, an excellent biologist, and in most cases, he was able to identify the important similarities that distinguished groups of organisms from each other. With the near universal acceptance of evolution among biologists soon after the publication of Darwin's The Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection, or The Preservation of Favored Races in the Struggle for Life, Linnaeus's groupings remained largely unaltered. But the cause behind the hierarchical pattern of diversity was very different indeed. Among Darwin's revelations was that all life shared a common descent, and that diversity was due to successive branchings of species over time. Although we also recognize that in some cases, new species may be created by combining two existing species. The hierarchical pattern of Linnaeus's classification was now considered to reflect an overall similarity that was due to the common ancestry of each of the different groups. Groups of organisms that shared a relatively recent common ancestor and tended to resemble each other closely fell together in a lower rank, whereas those sharing fewer similarities had a more remote common ancestry and fell together only in a higher rank. Thus, Canis lupus and Canis latrans, which are similar to each other, share a relatively recent common ancestor and are in the same genus. Canis and Felis, the genus including several smaller cats, are less similar. They share a common ancestor in the more distant past and are grouped together in the order Carnivora. The Carnivora and the order Rodentia, rodents, are even less similar, share an even more remote common ancestor, and are united in the class Mammalia. Within the last few decades, however, the classification of organisms has undergone a major restructuring, mainly as a result of the relatively recent methodology of recognizing evolutionary or genealogical relationships among organisms known as phylogenetic systematics. At first glance, much of the old system seems to have survived this recent intellectual development. For example, many of Linnaeus's groups and their names and ranks seem the same. However, there are several key differences. One concerns the method by which organisms are classified. As noted before, the older classifications were based essentially on general overall similarity. However, It turned out that the use of overall resemblance often led to misleading interpretations of the evolutionary relationships among organisms. Specific features were identified as more important than others, but decisions on which were important enough were usually left to an authoritative researcher regarded as an expert on a particular group of organisms. As might be expected, this was a rather subjective way of going about things. Biologists began to grasp that organisms cannot be defined, in contrast to inanimate things, on characters. Instead, groups of organisms are defined on ancestry. A meaningful classification can only be based on ancestry, because characters evolve, and some members of a group may lack one or more defining characters. For example, tetrapoda, or stegocephalia, according to several researchers, Dr. Iuliis and Pulera, 2010, includes all vertebrates with four limbs. If we were to adhere strictly to this definition of this group, then snakes could not be included. In practice, biologists have long realized that snakes share ancestry with other reptiles and have been classified with them and other vertebrates as tetrapods. Biologists do, of course, make use of characters, especially to infer what the evolutionary relationships are, and to diagnose, as opposed to define, groups which help us recognize them. But it took some time before they understood that the only characters useful in delineating evolutionary relationships are those that are modified in an ancestor species and then inherited by its descendant species. Unmodified characters present in the ancestor and passed on to descendants are not useful. For example, dogs, horses, and kangaroos all possess hair, a universal mammalian condition presumably present in and inherited from the earliest mammalian ancestor. One task of biologists is to understand the evolutionary relationships among organisms. At this level, the presence of hair tells us that these three animals share a common ancestor and belong in the same group. What about the relationships among them? A biologist would want to know whether the dog is more closely related to the horse or the kangaroo. In this situation, the presence of hair is of no help. A useful character would be one that is present in only two of the three, say the dog and horse, but not the kangaroo. Such a character would be evidence that the dog and horse share this particular feature, because it was derived from a more recent common ancestor. Scientists, not surprisingly, refer to these sorts of characters as shared derived characters. A derived character is technically termed an apomorphy, and a shared derived character is technically termed a synapomorphy. The more general presence of hair is a primitive, or more appropriately, an ancestral character, technically termed a plesiomorphy. A shared plesiomorphy is a symplesiomorphy. A group that includes an ancestor and all of its descendants is a natural or monophyletic group, also termed a clade. When scientists present classifications, they are actually proposing hypotheses on the phylogenetic or genealogical relationships among the organisms under study. Further data, for example, the discovery of new fossils, can cause a revision of phylogeny. The critical point is that in carrying out phylogenetic studies, scientists are attempting to reconstruct the unfolding of life. During the course of evolution, new species have typically come into being through descent with modification from ancestors. An ancestral species split to produce new species. We are trying to reconstruct or discover the pattern of this descent. As this pattern of descent is a historical process, it happened only one way. For example, if we are dealing with three species, A, B, and C, then the possible relationships among them are that species A and B are derived from species C, or species A and C are derived from species B, or species B and C are derived from species A. However, only one of these possibilities actually did occur. Another way of thinking about this is that the tree of life only occurred once. A monophyletic group is therefore not an arbitrary construct. It represents what we accept, until we can demonstrate otherwise, as the true pattern of the unfolding of life. Two groups, be they species or some higher and more inclusive taxa, that are each other's closest relatives because they share a common ancestor to the exclusion of other species, are termed sister groups. The reconstruction of genealogical relationships among organisms, or phylogeny, along these guidelines led to a clear idea of how to represent these relationships in the classification of organisms. Any grouping of organisms must reflect the genealogical history of its members. All the organisms included within a group must be more closely related to one another than to organisms in other groups. Another way of saying this is that a group must include an ancestor and all of its descendants. This may seem obvious, but classifications began to apply this principle consistently only beginning about 30 to 40 years ago. Before this, much of our classification was based on symplesiomorphic rather than on synapomorphic characters, or on some combination of the two. An example of this older method of classifying organisms is that the class Reptilia encompassed a wide array of organisms, including not only the living turtles, lizards, snakes, crocodiles, and their extinct relatives, dinosaurs, pterosaurs, and plesiosaurs, among others, but also the extinct relatives of mammals. Most of the latter, traditionally termed the mammal-like reptiles, were almost certainly more reptile-like in their overall appearance and way of life, but they nonetheless share a more recent common ancestry with the mammals than with the other reptiles. Not only this, but the older system excluded some of the descendants of the reptiles. Birds, certainly sharing common ancestry with turtles, lizards, snakes, crocodiles, dinosaurs, pterosaurs, and plesiosaurs, were grouped on their own in the class Aves, and mammals, sharing ancestry with the mammal-like reptiles, were likewise separated as the class Mammalia. For both of these groups, the ancestor was not grouped with them. To rectify this, the mammal-like reptiles were removed from the Reptilia and grouped with their living and extinct mammalian descendants in the group Synapsida, and the Aves were included within the larger group of reptiles. Such groups as the old concept of Reptilia is an example of an artificial group. It is not a natural group because it does not include an ancestor and all of its descendants. In this situation, when a group includes an ancestor but not all of its descendants, the group is described as paraphyletic. Another kind of artificial group is termed polyphyletic. In this case, the group includes organisms that have more than one ancestral source. Polyphyletic groups place together organisms on the basis of a few characteristics that were derived independently rather than inherited. An example is an older classification that recognized elephants, rhinoceroses, and pigs, among others, as belonging to a group, Pachydermata, based on the presence of a thick skin. This sort of similarity, in which organisms share features that are independently or convergently evolved, is termed homoplasy, and it can often be a source of confusion in reconstructing phylogeny. One final and more recent development is that the Linnaean practice of assigning formal rankings to groups is beginning to be abandoned. The reason for this is simple. If the history of life proceeds by successive branchings of species to produce a tree of life, then there is no objective way to equate one group of organisms in one part of the tree with any other group in another part of the tree. Thus, there is no point in trying to say that Mammalia and Reptilia are equivalent and deserve special recognition as classes. Systematists are therefore starting to simply refer to groups of organisms by name without any attempt at recognizing rank. Steno and stratigraphy. Paleontology is the intersection between the areas of knowledge that study life and the Earth. A substantial part of that confluence, needed to understand the relationships between rocks, organisms, and time is stratigraphy. This branch of geology deals with strata, those sedimentary rocks that lie in beds or layers. Sedimentary rocks are rocks formed by the settling, consolidation, and lithification of sediments, particles that are carried or suspended by wind or water. Sediments are formed by the weathering of previously existing rocks, minerals precipitated from solution, or minerals used by organisms to form skeletons. There are different aspects of stratigraphy, such as those concerned with the rocks themselves and their features, called lithostratigraphy, lithos, stone or rock, those that study the correlations established by the shared fossil contents of rock bodies, or biostratigraphy, bios, life, and those that have to do with the time in which the rocks were formed, or chronostratigraphy, chronos, time. Correlation is a crucial concept, essential to this whole discipline. It can be defined as the establishment of spatial and especially temporal correspondence between separate stratigraphic units. Although it can be said that the whole Earth is stratified, in the case of rocks, the strata are recognized on the basis of discontinuities due to changes in the conditions in which they were deposited, as well as the effects of erosion. The principles of stratigraphy were proposed by the Danish anatomist, geologist, and bishop Niels Stenson, better known, as noted by Rudwick, by his literary name, Stenonis, anglicized as Nicholas Steno, and they remain the fundamental concepts of the discipline. The principle of original horizontality. As most sedimentary particles settle out from fluids by gravity, the sediment is deposited in layers that are nearly horizontal and parallel to the surface on which they are accumulating. The principle of strata superposition. In a sequence of undisturbed strata, or layers, the oldest layer is lowest in the sequence, at the bottom, and successively higher layers are successively younger. The principle of lateral continuity. Strata extend in all directions until they terminate by thinning out at the edge of a basin, end against some former barrier to deposition, or grade into a different kind of sediment. According to this, if a layer does not continue, we may assume that displacement of strata or erosion has occurred, and that the strata can be followed at some other location, as on, for example, the other side of a gorge. Clearly, the disruption of strata must occur after the deposition of strata. To the modern listener, these three principles may seem trivial, but in Steno's time, they were revolutionary ideas and formed the basis of the theoretical framework that began allowing geologists to unravel the geologic history of the Earth. In most cases, strata are not neatly arranged. Rather, they are often folded and distorted. Sometimes a sequence may be entirely overturned. However, by following Steno's principles, geologists could begin to work out the historical sequence of events that must have occurred to produce a particular configuration of strata. This practice began in earnest during the 19th century, when geology was the science in vogue, and continued into the 20th century. But two other theoretical concepts were necessary before geologists could understand the sequence over which life on Earth had unfolded. We choose the word unfolded carefully, rather than saying evolved, because most geologists, particularly during much of the 19th century, did not accept biological evolution. One was the principle of uniformitarianism, or actualism, formulated by the Scottish physician and geologist James Hutton, 1726 to 1797, who viewed the Earth as a dynamic, ever-changing place. New rocks, lands, and mountains rose as a balance against destruction by erosion and weathering. Hutton's method was to explain the history of the Earth by observing the present, reasoning that the same processes that occur in the present also occurred in the past, and could be used to explain how the Earth's geologic features had come into being. Incidentally, a much more famous geologist, Charles Lyell, 1797 to 1875, made his mark largely by championing and amplifying Hutton's ideas, and his work was among the influences on Charles Darwin's development of evolutionary theory. Refer to Chapter 2. Though Lyell, also Darwin's friend, was able to accept a changing and ancient Earth, he did not accept biological evolution until later in his life. At any rate, Hutton's dynamic view of a continuously cycling series of processes that saw the buildup and destruction of geologic features led to his famous remark about the Earth, in which we find no vestige of a beginning, no prospect of an end. Among his contributions was his ability to correlate similar rock units at different localities. That is, he could say that such strata had been deposited at the same time. However, he had trouble determining whether dissimilar-looking strata were equivalent in age. The resolution to this last problem was supplied by William Smith, 1769 to 1839, an English surveyor, engineer, and canal builder. The link between canals in England and unraveling the history of life may seem elusive, but before the advent of the steam locomotive and development of the railroads, transportation in England was accomplished mainly by water routes, so that the country was crisscrossed by extensive canal networks. It was thus Smith's business to know the kinds and thicknesses of rock to cut through to build canals. He realized that stratified rocks occur in a particular sequence and could be identified on the basis of their lithology and the fossils they contain. That is, certain rocks units could be identified because they contained particular assemblages of fossils. Smith was thus able to correlate rock units over large distances. The reason for Smith's success is known as the principle of biological or fossil succession. The life forms of Earth's history are unique for particular periods of time, and they succeed one another in a regular and predictable way. Such fossil assemblages permit geologists to recognize contemporaneous deposits all over the world. Combined with the principles of stratigraphy, they could be used to arrange the rock sequences in different parts of the world into a chronologic sequence. This combination is known as biostratigraphy. Armed with these concepts, geologists went to work on piecing together the relative ages of outcrops all over the world by determining the sequence of strata in one place and then correlating it with sequences at other locations. They began to subdivide time on the basis of such sequences, with a sequence in one part of the world serving as a basis for comparison, thus established as the type locality, to strata in other parts of the world. Eventually, these 19th and early 20th century geologists constructed, in piecemeal fashion, the geologic time scale, which arranged the rocks on Earth into their relative temporal sequence, or geochronology. Much of this work, especially the broad subdivisions of Earth's history, was completed by the beginning of the 20th century. Finally, we were able to understand the progress of life, but only in a relative sense. With relative dating, we could tell what came before what, but could not say in absolute terms how much time had elapsed since any particular event. Although several attempts were made to determine absolute time, they turned out to be generally quite off the mark, particularly the deeper in time we went. Attaching a value in real time to events in Earth's history had to await the discovery of radioactivity in the final years of the 19th century, and then the development of techniques allowing the application of this concept to the dating of rocks. Although it had been shown in the first decade of the 20th century that it was possible to date radioactive rocks, it was not until the 1940s and 1950s that methods were developed to allow the principle of radioactivity to be used in a consistent and systematic manner. Essentially, there were two developments during this period. One was that allowing organic matter to be dated directly on the basis of the radioactivity of an isotope of carbon. The other, that radioactivity of several other elements in igneous rocks, those formed by the solidification of molten rock or magma, would provide a reliable way of dating the formation of the rock itself. Radioactive dating works on the facts that some isotopes of certain elements decay, and that the rate of decay is constant and can be measured. An isotope is a naturally occurring form of an element. For example, carbon exists in various forms, the most frequent being carbon-12 and carbon-14. Some, but certainly not all, isotopes decay. That is, they change into a stable isotope of the same element or another element altogether. The common carbon-12 is not radioactive and is therefore stable. It remains carbon-12. But carbon-14 is radioactive, and so it decays over time, eventually changing into nitrogen-14. We say that the parent, unstable isotope decays into its daughter, stable isotope. Radioactivity refers to the fact that decaying isotopes emit energy as they change from one substance into another, because in the process, matter is converted to energy. But this is incidental to our discussion. We are interested in how the phenomenon can be used to date rocks and organic material. The rate of decay for any particular isotope is constant and is termed its half-life. A half-life is the time required for half of a parent isotope to decay into its daughter isotope. Thus, if we start at time zero with a sample containing 100% of the parent isotope, after one half-life, there will be 50% parent and 50% daughter isotopes. After another half-life has passed, there will be 25% parent and 75% daughter isotopes, and so on. Dating involves calculating the ratio of parent to daughter isotopes, except in the case of carbon. An important condition is that we need to be sure that the sample being dated was composed initially of the parent isotope only. And for this reason, the rocks most used in estimating ages for fossil remains are those of igneous origin. The volatile nature of molten rock disrupts any parent-daughter isotope association, and they go their separate ways. When molten rock begins to cool and solidify, any coalescing radioactive isotope will consist entirely, or almost so, of parent isotope. This is time zero, and we can be assured that the dating of such a sample also represents the time of solidification, and hence, formation of the rock. The reason this is worth remembering is that we can date any rock fragment that contains radioactive isotopes, but that gives us the time elapsed since the particular rock fragment was formed. The fragment can, at some later time, become incorporated into another rock, such as, for example, a layer of sandstone. But the age of the rock fragment does not provide us with the age of the sandstone. If we are interested in any fossils in the sandstone, which were deposited as the sandstone was being formed, and thus are as old as the sandstone, then we have to find a way of estimating the age of the sandstone. The most straightforward way of doing this is to find a layer of igneous rock above and another below the sandstone, and date these two layers. As the two igneous layers bracket the sandstone, the age of the sandstone will be between those of the igneous layers. Of course, if fossils happen to be preserved in an igneous layer, then dating the layer also gives the date of the fossils. There are several parent-daughter series that are commonly used, each having a different half-life and thus applicable to different rocks and time. The ages of many of the fossil mammals we discuss in this book are based on carbon dating, which dates organic material rather than rock. This particular method is based on the fact that living organisms incorporate carbon into their component parts, such as the skeleton, in the same ratio as present in the atmosphere. Thus, the carbon in the bones of a mammal will be composed of carbon-12 and carbon-14 in the same ratio in which these isotopes are found in the environment. As soon as the mammal dies, it stops incorporating any new carbon, and anything else, of course. The carbon-12 remains stable, but the carbon-14 being radioactive, starts to decay, so that over time, the ratio of these two isotopes in its bones will differ from the ratio in the atmosphere. On the basis of the difference in the ratios, and given that we know the half-life of carbon-14, we can determine the time that has passed since the mammal died. Note that in this particular method, the important ratio is not between parent and daughter isotopes. Carbon-14 decays into nitrogen-14, but between the two carbon isotopes. The half-life of carbon-14 is about 5,700 years, which is relatively short and limits the reliability of dates obtained by this method to about 50,000 years. The reason is that after several half-lives have passed, there would be so little of the parent isotope remaining that determining accurate amounts is difficult, thereby increasing the likelihood of error. There are also other limitations to carbon dating, such as the rather likely possibility of contamination of a sample by other organic material, such as vegetation, and the fact that it is now clear that the ratio of carbon-12 to carbon-14 is not constant, but can and has varied over the time for which the method is used. Scientists make allowances for such factors, but other methods have also been devised for dating organic remains, such as electron spin resonance. The last point to consider with absolute dating is the apparently odd values given to divisions of Earth history. Many listeners may have wondered why scientists have chosen to use such inconsistent time intervals for the divisions. For example, the boundary between the Eocene and Oligocene occurred approximately 33.7 million years ago, that between the Miocene and Pliocene about 5.3 million years ago. Why not simply use convenient multiples of, say, 5 or 10, which would make remembering the dates much easier? The reason is that the divisions were essentially established by the beginning of the 20th century, whereas absolute dating of these divisions got underway more than half a century later. As we noted earlier, when a sequence of strata was first described, geologists established a particular example of that sequence as the type sequence, and all other similar sequences were compared to the type. In other words, the boundary between any two particular time units is defined on rocks in a particular location on Earth, and that is where the division is. If we want to know the absolute time of the boundary, we must go to the type locality and date the particular layer that geologists have determined as representing the boundary. There is also another reason. Each of the divisions is meant to represent a particular time interval in which the Earth, and especially the life it bore, was marked by particular features. It is not by chance that most mass extinctions occurred precisely at the end of periods, or even eras. Stratigraphic units. Lithostratigraphic units. According to the hierarchy, from more general to more specific, they are as follows: supergroup, group, formation, the basic unit, member, and bed. The basic unit is the formation, which is defined as a body of rock with particular lithological features that can be mapped at a scale of 1 to 10,000 or higher. Biostratigraphic units. These are units of rock characterized by their fossil content, called zones or biozones. This concept is related to the existence of some fossils, called index fossils, that have a short biochron, or lifespan, and a wide distribution. Chronostratigraphic and geochronologic units. The chronostratigraphic units are the body of rock formed during a certain time interval. The units of geologic time during which those rocks were formed are called geochronologic units. Both units have a strict correspondence. Chapter 2. Distinguished Paleomammalogists. In any human activity, there are people who distinguish themselves, whether through bold ideas or the pioneering character of their efforts, but always on the basis of hard work, such as those commemorated in the niches of the facade of the Museo de la Plata. For the paleontology of South American mammals, there are a few investigators to be included in the pantheon, and their feats with pick and pen are recounted and closely imitated. The following roster includes some of the people that most current South American mammalian paleontologists would include in their short lists. Some of them never set foot in South America, but worked on materials sent back to their home institutions, for example, Cuvier and Owen, whereas others, foreigners or native South Americans alike, for example, Darwin, Lund, the Ameghinos, Kraglevich, spent time there in excavating fossils, publishing on them, or both. By and large, the non-native researchers often arrived with the then most current conceptual and methodological tools, whereas many of the natives had to overcome both intellectual and institutional isolation, an interesting, though incidental, parallel to the conditions of the South American mammals themselves, in which they had to work. Florentino Ameghino was clearly an exception, in large part because he had managed to travel to Europe to collaborate with some of the leading scientists of the day. Although sometimes disparaged for having invaded and carted away precious fossils, the foreigners were instrumental in both studying South American fossils, thus making them known to the rest of the scientific community, and inspiring or directly assisting in the formation of a paleontological research community in South America. Cuvier. Baron Georges Cuvier, 1769 to 1832, to give just two of his numerous names, was undoubtedly the greatest anatomist of his day, and one of the best of all time. In addition to his numerous scientific contributions, the French scientist, though he was born to Swiss parents and completed his formal education in Stuttgart, is generally recognized as the founder of the sciences of vertebrate paleontology and comparative vertebrate anatomy by virtue of his Recherche sur les ossements fossiles, où l'on rétablit les caractères de plusieurs animaux dont les révolutions du globe ont détruit les espèces. He was not a main player in the story of South American mammals, but his dabbling produced two important milestones. One is that he described, in his first publication on fossil vertebrates, one of the largest late Pleistocene South American giant ground sloths, Megatherium americanum, on the basis of a specimen recovered from Luján in 1788 or 1789. Luján is a small city in Buenos Aires province, Argentina. It has become famous for its fossil treasures. There's been some confusion as to the subject of Cuvier's initial foray into fossil mammals, with his report on fossil proboscideans, elephants and their kin, sometimes considered first. But the report on Megatherium americanum was published before that on proboscideans. Because this was Cuvier's first paper on fossil vertebrates, a legitimate case might be made for regarding it as the seminal paper of this biological discipline, and thus for Megatherium americanum as the subject of this important landmark. Incidentally, before Cuvier described this specimen, it had been sent to the Real Gabinete de Historia Natural in Madrid, where it was prepared by Juan Bautista Bru de Ramón, 1784 to 1786, who was employed by the museum in a position akin to that of the modern preparator or conservator. Further, Bru mounted and illustrated the skeleton in a lifelike position, the first fossil skeleton to be so mounted. The pose given by Bru was incorrect, but the exhibit has remained nearly unchanged, although it was remounted at least once, thus preserving the original attempt at reconstructing the life pose of an extinct vertebrate. Bru was apparently set to publish his own description of the skeleton, but his as-yet-unpublished illustrations fell into the hands of Cuvier, who hurried into print in 1796. In any case, Cuvier considered the giant sloth important for other reasons. He recognized that nothing like it existed in modern times. In other words, it had become extinct, which was a revolutionary idea at the time. During the few decades before and after the turn of the 19th century, biology, then known as natural history, was in the midst of a conceptual transformation, moving gradually away from a theological mindset for explaining the pattern of life on Earth toward more modern evolutionary ideas. At the beginning of this period of change, what a fossil represented was still not entirely clear. As noted in Chapter 1, the word fossil referred to items such as gems and odd concretions, as well as the lithified remains or traces of once-living organisms that are now gathered unambiguously under the rubric of paleontology. Among the more amusing examples were the natural internal casts of certain brachiopods, a kind of shelled marine animal that bear an uncanny resemblance to female genitalia and were hence termed hysteroliths, or womb stones. The mystery of their formation was resolved by the middle of the 18th century, just a few decades before Megatherium americanum was described. Cuvier reasoned that if analysis of fossil bones by the powerful new methods of comparative anatomy could prove that they had belonged to species distinct from any known alive, the reality of extinction would be proved almost beyond dispute. This conclusion was first suggested to Cuvier by the Megatherium remains. Although the importance of extinction to evolutionary theory as understood by modern science was still in the future, coming with the publication in 1859 of Charles Darwin's The Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection, or The Preservation of Favored Races in the Struggle for Life, Cuvier claimed that extinction was a reality and opposed the idea that fossil animals had been transformed into living species. The latter theory, which virtually denied the existence of extinction, was gaining in popularity during the first few decades of the 19th century and was favored by such great biologists as Jean-Baptiste de Lamarck. Although Cuvier has thus often been cast in a negative light as being an anti-evolutionist, his work greatly contributed to the proper understanding of fossils as representing forms of life that are, generally but not exclusively, no longer in existence. It is unfortunate that our modern image of Cuvier has suffered ignoble slings and arrows, but this is almost entirely of our own making, for posterity has often judged him on the basis of a modern understanding of natural phenomena, rather than appreciating his efforts and ideas in the context of his own life and times. Indeed, scientists and historians of science tend to do this rather frequently, which may say more about modern thinkers than their intellectual forebears. Typically, for the particular period of biology in question, the benchmark of glory is usually the acceptance of evolution, and in particular, evolution by natural selection, or Darwinism. Those who were sufficiently capable intellectually of steering clear of prejudices to perceive objective truth that was based on empirical evidence are deemed worthy. The others are bit players, although some did have a few interesting things to say. In Cuvier's case, there are two sources of supposed error that contribute to his present stature: his beliefs in the non-changing nature of species and in the geologic concept of catastrophism. His adherence to these ideas has generally been viewed as due to the unyielding strength of his conventional theological convictions that species had become extinct by successive and divinely induced catastrophic revolutions of the globe, and new species had been created to replace them. However, this is incorrect. Cuvier did not consider biblical scripture to be particularly reliable when it came to explaining the diversity and history of life. He believed, for example, that the earth was ancient and that empirical evidence was required to decide issues of earth's history. One of Cuvier's main goals was to show that the earth was indeed very old by using successive fossil assemblages. To accomplish this, he needed to show that the organisms embedded in rocks were restricted to, that is, that they had lived and gone extinct during particular periods of time. The methods of comparative anatomy alluded to previously were pioneered by Cuvier. He believed he had uncovered a general biological law, the correlation of parts, that allowed the prediction of the form of parts of an organism from other parts. Parts, or structures of an organism, were designed to perform specific functions, and their form was such that they were compatible with each other, working harmoniously to allow the organism to function properly and survive. From this, it follows that if one structure were changed, the parts would no longer mesh together to produce a functional organism, and the organism would fail. And so, Cuvier believed, species could not change. Although in hindsight we consider his view on species incorrect, it was just what Cuvier needed for explaining the broader perspective of Earth history. If species evolved, as suggested by Lamarck and others, then they merely changed over time rather than becoming extinct, precluding their use to calibrate past time and thus unravel geologic history. Cuvier's view that geologic change was explained mainly by episodes of catastrophic events was replaced during the 1800s by the idea of uniformitarianism, or actualism, refer to Chapter 1, which maintains that geologic history could be explained by the same sorts of processes that are still occurring today. One need look no further than, for example, present-day river deltas or lava flows, acting over immense periods of time to infer how thick rock sequences might have accumulated. Although catastrophism, as advanced by Cuvier, has not had many followers, at least in the scientific community, we have begun to appreciate that catastrophic events can play a major role in biological history. For example, that the demise of the dinosaurs and many other creatures at the end of the Cretaceous period was triggered by the impact of a huge asteroid.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.